Lord, David.
Yeah.
That's amazing.
When did you first read anything that was Marjorie Prime? What was your first?
Well, I was given the script when it was new by Pam McKinnon.
And it's 7 years ago, 8 years ago? Or
no, it's not that long. It's, you know, it's either, I'd say it may be as many as five, it may be four. I think it might be getting on towards 5 years ago. It seems amazing to me, but it was a while ago.
Well, you've done three different productions of it, and it's kind of a remarkable in 5 years.
Twice, and they didn't happen immediately. First of all, you read it and you try to interest theaters in it, and then the Taper was the first theater that decided to produce it. But there, when they decided, it was a year in advance, so that was a wait for that production. Then Michael Almereides saw that production and wanted to make a film of it, so. Actually, that was its next iteration, though, again, time went by. During that period between playing Marjorie Prime in Los Angeles at the Taper, and then I went home to New York and for a few months. Then I was doing a play at Steppenwolf in Chicago, and that was in the spring, the following spring. So, and right after that, I went back to New York and did Annie Baker's play John at the Signature Theater. And right after that, we shot the movie. By now we're about a year from the Taper production. So you see that there were periods of time between. Then we
and
shot.
Whose idea was it to go back to the stage with it after you'd already shot the movie?
Oh, we knew that the Playwrights Horizons, that was booked. It was ready to go. The movie had to be squeezed in there in that little window of time. So that's when it was. Yeah.
Did it change at all from one production to the next to the next?
Oh, sure. Everything changes, yeah. Different directors, partly different casts in each one, partly the same and stage partly different. Lisa Emery played Tess in both New York and L.A., and the men changed. It changes because one gets more used, more deep into it. Mm-hmm. It evolves. Rehearsals change things. And of course, then the movie, which was the middle one, that's a film. That's right. Really different. Everything's different. It's an adaptation. Most of my dialogue was not changed or not very much. Mm-hmm. Less of it, because there tends to be less words in a film, I think. Mm-hmm.
Do you have the experience of figuring it out, your character, as you go over doing the stage show?
Yeah.
Then you still have that in the third incarnation?
Before you start, you have thinking about it by yourself. Mm-hmm. It's always seemed to me one of the really wonderful things about being an actor. You first of all, you do what you do by yourself, and then you bring that in, and then you're all together. And everybody comes in with their own work, but then the work becomes a collaboration. And it's particularly collaborative for actors in the theater, I think. Mm-hmm. Because we work on building it together, we perform it directly with nobody between us and our audience. So it's a more more control for the actor on stage. That's nice.
So what made you think?
And you tell a story from beginning to end. That's also nice.
Well, is telling it? I mean, different actors have different opinions about it, but is telling it over and over and over and over again part of that process ultimately?
Part of the process, what?
Of finding the character as you're into.
Sure, yeah.
Before the 40th production.
You know, you're doing the same thing, but you're doing it as if for the first time. A trick, but a tricky thing to do. But in a way, that's always the challenge and the opportunity, I think. Yeah.
I think somebody told me once that they figured out their character. They finally figured out what the show was about and the closing night.
Yes, one hears that. Yeah. Yeah, or even you go home afterwards. Oh, yeah. A
now
month
it makes
later.
Sense.
Yeah.
So what made you think this is all a good idea in the first place?
Oh, I loved it the minute I read it.
No, no, not this movie, not this show, but just acting.
Just acting.
Did you think, were you a theatrical kid? Were you inevitably going to be an actress?
Very not in a way, and in a certain very personal way, yes. My father took acting and directing class, almost never went to the movies, was a religious man, a Protestant. We lived in Kansas. He was a kind of pillar of the church, and he wanted to put plays on in the church, and he learned to do it. I think that's just the darndest thing, but when he was doing this, I was very little, the youngest of six children, I think I adored tagging along, and I went to all the rehearsals. And those were certainly my first appearances, and being there. And of course, it had nothing to do with professional theater, or what he was interested in was it amazes me, but it mattered to him, this kind of dramatic storytelling. But he wanted it to be in the service of his faith and his church. So that's how it started. And then I just always liked it and always valued it and enjoyed it. And I guess as I went through my early life and would have an opportunity to, each time, I happened to go to a high school where there was, in Seattle, where we lived then, my family moved to Seattle, where there was a drama department. So I was doing plays both in class and much more than an ordinary English department would do.
Right.
I think it's about then that I began to realize, oh, each time I did it, I would rise to the top and think, okay, I can do this. And then the next thing I did was go to the University of Washington in Seattle, which happened to have a remarkable drama department at the time, where there were two theaters on campus for the drama department to perform in. They were plays year round. Every play played six nights a week for 6 weeks to a paid audience.
Wow.
Damnedest thing. The most remarkable experience. At the same time, I was at school, and our primary acting teacher, a man named Dan Harrington, had been in New York just at the time when all the Russians were coming over. So we were reading Boleslavsky and Stanislavsky, and that's what was happening in the American theater in New York, and he was bringing it west. So I was learning about drama and acting really for the first time in a really serious way, and that by then I think I was ready, hungry for that, had an appetite for it.
And pretty remarkable for that time period.
It is.
Yeah,
it really is.
This is pre-studio, right? This is...
The Actors Studio was founded just about then. It was, forgotten the year, but late 40s, I think. Yeah. I went to New York in 52 and started working. Yeah.
So was that scary to go to New York, or were your family encouraging?
My family was... I actually got married very young. I got married when I was barely 18. So I was married when I was in college. I was married my first days in New York. My husband was a classicist and was going to graduate school at Harvard. So we were living with one foot in Cambridge and one in New York for a few years. I was very fortunate, started to work right away. And... that's how it started, and that's how it grew.
So you were there for a lot of the live theater on television that was going on.
Oh, yes, my goodness. You know, I think hard for people, for young people to believe now. There were all these television shows which were plays, one every week, and must have been maybe a dozen shows doing that, putting anthologies of dramas, of plays on every... How about that for a... proving ground, a training ground.
Really. Well, one of the credits you have is like Art Carney Presents or something.
And yes.
Like, Art Carney was doing theater on stage, on television.
Yes.
But he was.
Yes, he was, yeah.
Yeah.
We had the same agent at that time. And he was doing a I don't remember how many he did, but yes, it was a play about. It was a play about a woman's orchestra.
Huh.
I think I may have been a violin player. Hey, like in Marjorie probably.
There you go.
Marjorie's
it all comes full circle.
Yeah, yeah.
So did you take to the professional business easily? Was there any real, I mean, it sounds like the work was similar to the theater work you'd been already doing.
I was.
In certain ways.
By great good luck, I think I was well prepared to start working professionally. Both in the television was like rehearsing a play. That's how we rehearsed it. And
right.
The first ones I did were live. So you really were just doing the play for the cameras. And later that changed and they began to tape them. And then, of course, film, which my first film was East of Eden, and that's a very different system, you know, where right. you're not doing it in. I mean, in that I had just one major scene, so it's not as though I was at that point dealing with the out-of-sequence nature of things being shot.
Right. Was it that a big change? Did it seem very different? Or
oh, yes. Oh, yes. Yeah, I mean, the work in a way comes from the same seeds, I suppose, but yes, mm-hmm. it's very different to work for, yeah, bits of the piece in front of the, to be photographed. That's very different, yeah. Mm.
Were you ambitious at that age?
I guess
age?
I must have, you know, I think I've always been ambitious to work. I love to work. I don't think I've been particularly ambitious about fame and fortune. I think I've been really fortunate. I've made my living as an actor since the first time I acted. Now that's not easy in this current climate, you know? And that's really because I was able to do television, film, and stage and always have done them all, and it's hard to make a living just on the stage. So I think it's the playwright Robert Anderson who made this wonderful comment, probably mostly about playwrights, but it could certainly apply to mm-hmm. all of us. You know, you can't make a living, but you might make a killing. And that's kind of the way it is as a profession.
So yeah. has it been pretty even for you over all these years? I mean, it's a 60-year career. It's remarkable.
I think if I look back, I would, and you can say maybe sort of at the time it didn't seem even. Nothing ever seems even. I mean, I didn't know what was next most of the time.
Right.
And you know, I think fairly early on, I must have realized maybe with some help of conversing with other people. Well, I chose this. I didn't choose to know where I'd go every morning to work and what time I'd, you know. So I chose it.
Mm-hmm.
And it's still peculiar. One of the things when you're in a play, well, I guess it's anything, but it's your hours keep changing and the system of hours and how the work goes and, of course, the concentration. And so I never know, often don't know. It's not as though even there's a regular lunch hour. As a matter of fact, as rehearsals get squished, there's often isn't one or a mm-hmm. tiny one. So you think, when do I eat? What do I eat? How do I eat? And how do I fit it? And just as you may have begun to get a handle on it, the hours change. Now you're not going to rehearsal in the morning. You're going to play at night and you're home at midnight. It's an unbalanced life. And again, I chose it, you know?
And have you come to like it, or is it still,
you know,
like riding a horse?
That's what I do and have done for a long time with all its changeableness. I guess I must like it. Mm. Yeah, I guess I like it.
I mean, I assume in your real life you have more steady, even you know, consistency that you can
I've been very fortunate. It hasn't been the most. I had a marriage, a fairly long marriage. I have one child. But the marriage ended, and after that, a while after that, I have I had a boyfriend, David Margulies, and although it was volatile and sometimes on and off, it was long, and I say was because he died a year and a half ago, just in the midst of all of this, of Marjorie Prime, of this enormous amount of work on top of each other, almost more than And so that was dreadfully hard in so many ways. But it was a long, while not constant, in a certain way, constant, long relationship.
Mm. Yeah. Are you a person who looks back? Do you think about your past much, or do you linger on it, or you kind of just keep moving?
Well, I guess everybody probably does both. I don't think I'm awfully good at remembering. Sometimes I'm amazed how much I can't remember, but keep going, I guess. Yeah.
Do you think you like yourself as an actor?
Like myself as an actor?
Are you a fan of yourself? Are you very, very critical or not? Or think you're kind of got it figured it out? Or
oh. Every time it's a new beginning and a new. I mean, I am certainly more experienced than I used to be, and that means a lot. Mm. I think I'm better. I think my threshold is higher, you know? I think so. On the stage, of course, I don't see what I do. Mm-hmm. So it's odd. I've seen this movie. I never saw me do it on the stage. you know.
Do you measure it? I mean, do you
evaluate it?
Evaluate yourself? Or are you?
I think what I can't help doing so,
right.
But maybe less than. Sometimes it's really distressing. Sometimes it's. There are moments you're pleased with. It's hard to give it it's not a steady thing. It's not something. It's the doing of it which makes me cook, you know.
So is it all the pieces, or is there a particular part you like the best? I mean, is it? Are you happier in rehearsals? Are you happier when the show is up? Or is it all part of the same?
Overall, I would say I love rehearsals. Although sometimes they are so hard, or the problem you don't know how to solve, or you get there are times when I've gotten really, really upset, at my wit's end, and that's not fun. But of course, it is. And I begin to think, oh yeah, I guess I go through this, and that's not the first time I've felt this way. But I do like rehearsals. It's a different part of the process. I think I like it all. I don't know.
Are you a big researcher?
Big.
Researcher? Do you?
I don't think I'm a particularly big researcher. One thing that happened in the course of the time I've been doing this, it began to happen with institutional theaters, the regional theater movement came up, and the staffs of the nonprofit theaters very often includes dramaturgs. And when there's a production dramaturg, one assigned to, that's what they love to do. Mm-hmm. And that can be a lot of fun. And you get the advantage of somebody else's thinking, oh, what might this relate to? And, you know, and going, you sometimes get history or information is helpful. I'm not a particularly big scholarly researcher myself, though I greatly appreciate the people who do that.
And so you dig in with what's on the page. The script comes to you.
Oh, that very much. And you know, and more recent, I didn't used to learn my lines ahead of time. I never grew up that way, and never did it. And not maybe as much as 20 years ago, I began to decide to learn, especially if it's a big part with a lot of, to learn it ahead of time. And I love it. I love, love, love that. I love the work by myself with the text. It is so enriching. I learn this play in a way that I never, that I found a way into it that was so pleasing. And I love to do that. Also, when you get to rehearsal with your fellows, we don't have very long rehearsal periods, and they keep getting shorter. Economy is what squeezes that, of course.
Yeah.
But you don't take a lot of time while you're still looking at the page, you can look in your partner's eyes or wherever you want to look sooner. You can begin to play the part because you have really paid attention. I have paid attention before I get there. I know the words usually pretty well. Often if you know the words and then you begin to work, you lose them again. But that's all right. Mm-hmm. Of course you do, because other things are happening to you. And the memory of the memorizing of the words and the playing of the thing are all different parts, and they have to merge together. It doesn't happen in a minute. Sometimes it does, but it's a big, that's what rehearsal is, you know. We do it with each other, we do it with ourselves. I love that we each bring ourselves and then we do it together. Great, great thing.
It's like building a little family every
It is.
Few months.
Yeah.
So is acting what you... Has acting changed for you over all these years? Or is really the work, even though you've changed methods a little bit, is the work pretty much the work that you were doing when you were 30 years old?
I think I have more freedom. That's what I like the best, when I can work freely. And I guess it's partly up to me to be grounded enough, and it's partly up to the situation, which is always different. You never know.
Have directors changed much over all these years?
It's hard to say, you know. I think there have probably always been all kinds. I think so.
But has it gotten looser in that way? Do actors get more respect, do you think?
I don't think so. Overall, I would say not. I don't think... I mean, again, it depends on the... I've been very lucky and worked in actor-friendly. I was a member of the Actors Studio, the Stephen Wolf Ensemble, which is founded by actors, has been actor-centered for its, what is it now, 40 years or so?
Yeah. All those kids have grown up.
And I... been part of the Ensemble Studio Theater in New York, which was founded about the same time by Kurt Dempster, a director as the Chicago Steppenwolf, and I've been a member of that since its beginning, which is again just a developmental theater where probably the main emphasis is on playwrights to develop play. Certainly, it is now. There's a part of it called Young Blood, which is it's been going on for years, where very young playwrights come and they work hard and they write. That is, they don't sit around; they really write. And actors do their plays in a little venue and a bigger venue. So the actor is not as central at the Ensemble Studio Theater, but it is. But ensemble is the point of the... So I've had a lot of my life, which is how I don't think I could have managed if there was little of that. Sometimes you go to a job, like maybe a short not that television jobs can't be wonderful, and I've had some that are, and films too, they're all kinds. But you're probably more apt to find a harsher, commercial, indifferent attitude in that is really no fun, you know. You may manage to do something, but that's not the kind of work that makes me happy.
So do you eat like you work?
What do you mean?
do you eat something different every day and change it up every day?
You know,
it sounds
I
like you have flavor taste for a lot of different flavors.
You know, I think that I am actually, I think maybe my eating is changing, and it's partly not wanting to. I love to go out to dinner, and that's I love it when something interesting, and it could be anything different each night. So I guess but if I'm at home feeding myself, I will tend to eat very simple things that are really quick to fix. Not, I can cook and I do, but mostly I'm not. That's changed as I have gotten older. I think I have less tolerance, energy, willingness to spend the time for what's required to shop, to cook, to clean up. Ooh, that's a big deal. I used to give dinner parties that were really quite good. And I keep thinking, oh, well, maybe I'll do that again. But then I think, maybe I won't, you know.
Sometimes I make my wife order food in for dinner parties so she doesn't have to work so hard. She really likes doing all that stuff, but
yes,
by the end of 2 days of it, she's exhausted.
I know, it's a great pleasure, but it's really hard, yeah. And I've lost my willingness to invest in that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's hard to imagine you ordering vanilla ice cream, though. It's hard to imagine you ordering a dish of vanilla ice cream and just... I'm feeling you might try another flavor now and again.
I'm not sure. I think I'm very conservative in some of my... in the effort for simplicity of... Yeah.
So do you get surprised when you become the, you know, superstar of the moment?
Oh, gosh.
When things happen? I mean, certainly happened with Minority Report and other films. And
well, it's really wonderful in the sense that it works and it makes me more likely to get even better things to do. And that's quite wonderful. And I'll tell you what else is wonderful. I think being a superstar would be pretty dreary. But I think I live in New York, which is very different from a sense of Hollywood fandom. It's really is different.
Yeah.
And the best thing, and I think, boy, am I not lucky that for me, success, I'm often recognized more in New York, and there's lots of theater goers, and I live in Manhattan, and but very, very often people say to me, even if it's not, oh, I saw you in, oh, can I take, oh, can I, it's, I love your work. Mm-hmm. Now, oh. Or sometimes it's something very specific, or they, and that's very satisfying because that's what it's for, and that's so nice. I don't like being chased around or valued as a, you know, it. I mean, in a way I understand it because it is fun for, I've never been much of a you know, somebody who chased autographs, or I'm not.
Yeah.
And the fact that some people are, that's okay, but I'm not exactly comforted or pleased by that, but I do like to be recognized and have been of value to some audience.
Well, I think about it in doing this, and you know, you meet people that you've never met before sometimes, and it's like, you know, they always say don't meet your heroes, but on some level the power of one performance in one movie, you know, much less a bunch of them or a bunch of pieces of theater. If you, you know, when you've taken the time to go to the theater and you have a great experience, one night in the theater can change your life and can really, you know,
that's
have an impact on you forever.
That's right. It can. Well, a story can. It can. A book can, too. I mean, yeah, but it, yes, but the theater is what.
But when you have that experience with an actor, you know, it's like, I remember I saw Mark Rylance for the first time in Boeing, which is like the weirdest show to see him in.
Yes, I know. It's the first time I saw him, too.
But he was... I don't think I've ever had a greater experience in the theater with an actor than that performance. It was a silly movie show, but what a performance!
It's so remarkable, isn't it?
Yeah.
Oh, I know. Maybe the first one I saw was, and I can never remember the title of it. Herzog wrote it, and it was the first like half an hour was just like him.
Right.
And he did it with David Hyde Pierce.
Hyde Pierce. I'm not sure.
It was. That one really made my jaw drop
at
almost everybody. I thought it's like this is on another plane. It really is. And then, you know, when he brought the two Shakespeares, I hadn't seen them before. Did you see the Twelfth Night?
But I didn't see Jerusalem, which makes me crazy.
You didn't see?
I heard he did. Apparently Jerusalem was...
Jerusalem was not my favorite of
really?
His. He's always wonderful, but the Twelfth Night... Can't get above that.
Do you know who loved Jerusalem was crazy for? It was Paul Mazursky, who was the one who told me. That was like, I knew Paul when he was, we used to hang out at the farmer's market in the mornings.
Oh, really?
Yes.
Yeah.
And often talked about next stop Greenwich Village. Because it was him. His life on a dish.
Yeah.
Yes. It was crazy. But yeah, the impact is, all it takes is that one, one moment.
Yeah.
And you're kind of with that person for the rest of your life.
Yeah. That is wonderful, isn't it? Yeah, I know. Yeah. I certainly have some of those. Yeah.
So were you ever starstruck?
I'm certainly star-impressed. I'm amazed at, you know, people do amazing things. I feel that way about Vanessa Redgrave. Oh, my. And Natasha Richardson, too, had that. And lots of people.
Yeah.
Can give you that kind of gift and thrill.
But I mean, are you, I guess you, when you started at such a young age and you're working with a lot of very famous people from the beginning, just kind of, it's everybody else is an actor. We're all actors and we're doing this and not that
kind of. Is everybody
else? No, everybody's an actor on the set. We're all working together. And, you know, James Dean is just James Dean.
Yeah.
Is that where you were? Is that where you
yeah,
were?
Yeah. I mean, he was wonderful. But, yeah. You know, he wasn't the iconic James Dean that he became, you know. He was really, really terrific, you know, playing that part so beautifully. Woo. Mm. Yeah.
Is it strange when that happens, when people you've worked with and has kind of had normal relationships with become these weird icons? And
it's the way it is. I don't know.
Yeah. You consume a lot of stuff? Do you watch movies and television?
I go to the theater. It varies. Lately, I've been going to the theater quite a lot. Sometimes I go to the movies, not a lot compared to most people I know, really, in this profession. And I haven't been watching television, though. I think that's too bad because there's so much. Everybody tells me they're wonderful television. I just got too busy for a while, in various ways, for a couple of years. And then you get out of the habit of doing it, of being being there for it, you know, in a way. And also, I'm not adept at modern technology, so I don't have all the right ways to bring
everything
in and see, you know, so I'm still thinking, well, I'll watch TCM. I love to watch it all.
Well, it's getting easier. There is that.
Yes, it is. Yes, that's true.
And now TCM has an app, so you can watch you can watch all the old stuff.
Yeah.
It'd be a lot of fun. So it sounds like the perfect year for you is a year when you do a TV thing, a movie thing.
It's pretty good.
A piece of stage work.
Yeah.
And you get to do a little bit of everything.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you ever get tired of it? Do you ever think, oh, I'm ready to retire, I'm done?
I sometimes say I love to work and I love to stop. And that certainly is true. I mean, you know, when it comes to, some people, you know, go into mourning when a play closes, but I don't. Usually, you know how it's going to be, the length, and I'm usually at peace with that, and that's fine. And I don't think, oh, if it only ran for 4 years, as a matter of fact, I think that might be a little hard. So
what's the longest you've stayed with a play?
My first job, I think, was the longest run I ever had. It was a play that opened in probably September and closed in June, a season on Broadway. And I don't think I've ever had a run that was longer than that. Now, in The Grapes of Wrath, we did four productions of it, you know, and over a period of a couple of years. Mm-hmm. It started at Steppenwolf.
Yeah.
We rehearsed it and played it, and we were working on it all the time. And when the end of that run came, there was obviously a great deal of interest in its further life, but didn't know what it would be. Mm-hmm. And actually, I went back to New York and did a production of Measure for Measure at Lincoln Center playing Mistress Overdone. Mm. And things got worked out with, we were invited to a festival in London and we couldn't go until we'd been able to work on the play again. So we went back to Chicago, rehearsed it again and opened the season in La Jolla Playhouse. And that was the second production and that's the one where it really began to happen and get there. We went straight from La Jolla to London and it was a big success. We were only there a couple weeks because they had things, international festival, and things came in, not at the same time, but they had to interrupt their rep, and, you know, so, and after that, then there was the money and theaters to bring it to Broadway, so we did, and that was another fully rehearsed rehearsal period, and so that, you don't get to do that very often, so maybe if I put them all together, and the time all that took, that may have been a longer. And then Marjorie Prime has some of that element of the time I was with it and still going on is, you know.
So what is it like with Steppenwolf with you? Do you just get called when somebody thinks you're the right one for something? Or?
Well, the ensemble, of course, when it started, they were all kids and they were all in the same place in Chicago. Mm-hmm. By the time I became a member, Grapes of Wrath was the first thing I did with them. And that was in the late 80s, and it was 90 on Broadway.
Mm-hmm.
In 93, I became a member of the ensemble. So now, even when I first worked with them, there were people on the West, in LA, people in New York, mm-hmm. and people in Chicago, and it was really spreading out. So it's hard to keep the ensemble in, because people, it's harder for the members, it's harder for me to decide to do a play there, though it's wonderful. And I do, and have done, and...
Do you get, like, August Osage County envy, or...?
No.
Do things come out of Steppenwolf, and you go, man, I should have done that.
No, I don't... Have I... There might have been occasional twinges of something that... But I'm not... It's a big deal for me to go there and do a play, right. So I have to really, you know... It mostly has been the other way. It was too attractive not to do it, so I go and do it.
Is there much in your career where you kind of, I wish I had done this, I wish I had done that, or is it just kind of worked out?
You know, yeah, I guess. It's always, isn't everything like sort of the balance? My balance has been, in this profession, really pretty fortunate, I think, so I haven't had a lot of work. But it's not as though there's, people say, oh, you're always working. You think, oh, no, that's not the way it was. And yet, I look back, yeah, sure, you could say I'm always working, but...
Well, 2 or 3 credits a year, every year for, you know, 60 years is pretty amazing.
It adds up, doesn't it?
Yeah. Well, so few actors have that, you know, have that happen, where they,
yeah,
you know, can have such a consistent career for such a long period of time. It's very unusual.
Lucky duck me, huh?
Yeah. Well, you seem very... it's funny, because we always talk about, you know, how people come in and out of their careers, and... Part of it is that people get, you know, some people get obnoxious, and who wants to work with an obnoxious person when there's another, you know, talented person who's not? You seem just very likable and focused and not an angry person. And
good. Oh, I like me. That's good.
Do you feel like you're, that's who you are? Do we get, I mean, you have a certain vibe. That's very peaceful, I guess, is the word. There's a certain power and control and calm.
I
when
really
you see
like
you work.
It. There are certain times, like when I was describing to you a bad time in rehearsal, when I just feel like the stupidest, upset person. But yes, overall, I don't think I am an angry or vindictive or, yeah.
So can you imagine retiring, or you think you're just going to keep on going, depending on, as long as good scripts show up?
I haven't been longing to retire, but now, it's not as though I work 9 to 5 every day with, I can imagine you'd want to retire and stop doing that. But I do something here, and then I don't do something, and then I do something else. So what's to retire from, you know? If I find interesting things to do and they give me pleasure, and even if they give other people pleasure too, that's pretty good. It's pretty good.
And Gina was saying last night Gina Davis was saying how she, you know, was looking forward to aging another 10 years so she could start competing with you for roles. But it was funny looking at your resume that, you know, even when you were 30 years old, there are a lot of Mrs. Whomevers in the, you know, your character names. Like, it seemed like you've played an adult since you were a kid. Pretty consistently.
No, I played ingenues when I started out, you know.
And then is there a switch to the mature version of you? I mean, was there a moment where you, like, became the...
Not a moment, but, you know, maybe, I may have said this to you, it's like, this is part of the subject of women's position, you know, you're playing daughters, then you're playing, you know, girlfriends, then you're playing young wives, then you're playing young mothers, then you're playing... That would occur to me and to lots of other people, I'm sure, and that is partly an aging thing as you move through the stages of life and of parts, but it's also often it would seem like, maybe especially in television, that the woman's role is in relation to some other role. So that is a big subject of Gina's, because she's worked on that and does work on that all the time, which is quite wonderful, you know, of the female in roles where there are enough of them and they are not subordinate, but primary. So I haven't felt lately as though I've had that, been trapped in that box at all. I've had really varied and interesting grown-up parts.
Has it changed, or is it just circumstance of each person's career that... I mean, when you were, it was the 50s and 60s, did you feel subordinated?
Well, I'm more well-known now.
Right.
There are probably not as many candidates for an 80-year-old good part as there are for a 40-year-old good part or a 25-year-old good part, you know?
Yeah.
So that must be part of it. Oh, there's probably also more of an interest, as the population demographic changes, I think lots of people are writing plays about their aging parents, for one thing, you know, so.
Yeah. Interesting.
Yeah.
I have a friend who was trying to cast a movie of 70-year-olds, and he had it just was brutal. And they finally figured out the guys, but then they had to find a woman. And it was even like, just a very narrow swath of people.
Is that true? You know, there. In a way, you'd think, there's so many actors who don't have enough work.
Well, it was they needed to cast somebody who had a name, you know.
Oh, yes. Well,
but
there
it was like, either you're still, if you're 70 or 65, either you're kind of a big star and very expensive because you've survived that long somehow.
Yeah.
Or you're not a big enough name for them to, you know, put on the marquee. Yeah. And it's a weird.
Oh, yeah, it is weird. I think I like most people, teeter through that hierarchy all the time. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, we're glad you're teetering.
Thanks, me too.
You're the great teeterer. Thank you so much for your time. I appreciate it.
Thank you, David. A pleasure.